your boot and do that yoga.
From Lululemon, Janelle Monae. I am Maggie Dawn. You are listening to the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We have got some weather coming our way, fans. Just a reminder, basically, if you're anywhere but Milwaukee, that's sort of the easy way to say this, sort of from Waukesha west, so Brookfield west, more or less, and then north, keep your wits about you. Check in on your neighbors that might live alone or need assistance. Help each other out there. Drive safely, slowly, and leave early because we're going to have some weather coming in. Always remember the top and bottom of the hours. You're going to hear news, weather, and sports here on the Civic Media Radio Network. You don't want to miss all of that, any of that, because, of course, the Packers made the playoffs? Say what?
Are you just finding out now?
No. Okay. I watched the boulder I live under is not quite that large.
Oh my.
I did watch yesterday, and what a wonderful thing for this youngest team, I think, in 40 years to make the playoffs, in 40 years of NFL history to make the playoffs, youngest team in the NFL. What an incredible accomplishment for Jordan Love. What a way to move on from the toxicity that remains the other guy that used to do this. What a way to move on from the toxicity that has become the other guy that used to do this. And there's just so much to love about Jordan Love. There's so much to love about this particular team, that football has again become for me enjoyable. I have been sort of multi-sport has been athlete. So multi-sport, wannabe good fan. Right. And I had a really difficult time mustering up any energy for the Packers with the prior guy. You became so unlikable, and forget the lying and the threats to his teammates and staff safety, which bad enough. But forget all that because it's political. Let's just keep it about the sports, right? My main problem with the guy that used to do this for the Packers was that this to me did not seem like a guy that I would want to line up behind and work with and let lead me. Right. And these are all incredible athletes. This just didn't seem like the sort of quarterback that a team would unite around. It seemed the sort of guy that put his needs above the needs of the team. And, you know, you skip practices. You don't think you need to do preseason work. All of that has a cultural impact and a big one. I never wish anybody ill. I certainly wish the former guy well and that he has recovered from his injury. That's terrible for a professional athlete. Injuries are bad. But just so, it makes this all the more sweeter for Jordan Love and this young Packers team. Especially because basically folks had counted them out mid-season. I was like, they're done, not making the playoffs, Canada, not happening. And then he wins Thanksgiving, wins Christmas Eve, wins New Year's Eve. I mean, how awesome is that? It's the holiday trifecta for Jordan Love and the Packers to beat the Bears last season of the last game of the season to get into the playoffs. Like, I don't know if things get more sweet. It's going to be a pleasure to watch the game next week, even if it's a rough game for us. I wish them the best. I hope they show up in their best selves and give a good game. But to me, this has been a successful season, and bravo, hats off to Jordan Love. What a different kind of leader. What a young guy, such enthusiasm. There's no cynicism. It just doesn't feel icky to me anymore to root for the Packers. So I'm loving it. I hope all of you are. The most important thing is that wherever you may be, wherever the snowstorm that's coming on Friday happens to waylay you for the weekend, you can dig in, you can go get your supplies, you can download the Civic Media app for free from any app store, and then you can listen to the Packers game with you and your friends wherever you are. It's going to be broadcast on many, many, many of the Civic Media radio stations across Wisconsin. So stay warm up there in Ashland County, in Green Bay, in Richland Center, east to west, north to south. Check on your neighbors. Check on your elderly friends and family. Shovel a driveway for somebody you care about, or maybe just because they live down the block from you. But let's keep it together. Let's keep a community and go Pack this weekend. But go ahead and download that app. You can take us everywhere with you. 844-967-2789. Let's get some work done here, Anya. If you give us a call or text, do say hello to Anya. She works with me, my partner in crime.
Hello, hello. That's me.
For all things. It's me. For all things the Maggie Dawn Show. She even will be perhaps stepping in to do a bit of substitute hosting for me this Thursday because I can't be with y'all. Let's do some work. Last week, Thursday, I had wanted to talk about Chip Wilson. He is the former CEO and founder of Lululemon. We started with some tunes from Janelle Monáe. That song's called Yoga because oh so appropriate. And Anya always finds the deep cuts to fit our topics for the day. Chip Wilson got interviewed by Forbes on a whole gamut of topics. I listened to the whole interview because it was really a fascinating study in personality characteristics of the billionaire class. And I wanted to share just some of the things from the interview that I thought were kind of, okay, then that's certainly an approach. That's one way to look at things and see what our collective reactions were, especially, you know, folks that may not always agree with what I'm saying. Like if you happen to maybe a little center right, maybe a little far right, I want to see if some of these things raise your eyebrows as much as they raised mine. Other than, you know, my Botox, I would be able to get them a little bit higher. I'm of that age, folks. So I want to start with one of the shorter cuts, and it's probably a good starting point before we got to take some messages. Listen, if you're on the line, stay there, 844-967-2789. If you want to join us, give your impressions about this, get yourself queued up because I want to hear from you. So here's the first cut. Now, what he's being, excuse me, this is going to be cut number two, act 2A, Anya, not one. So we're going to go with 2A. But the first one for our listening audience, let me set it up a little bit. Chip Wilson sold Lululemon, most of his shares, basically taking himself down to 8%-ish. He used to own 29%+ of Lululemon. And if you all recall, we had that little COVID coronavirus thing that continues to take 1,200 lives a week. And while we were all staying at home, Lululemon did real well because they sell yoga pants and athleisure wear. So their stock just exploded. But Mr. Wilson, not the guy from Home Improvement over the fence, but Mr. Chip Wilson, billionaire, he had sold his stock in 2013. So he would have been worth like 21 plus billion today based only on his Lululemon stock ownership. But instead, he sold off most of that and so left billions on the table. Now, the gracious Chip is doing fine. No one call an alarm for Chip. Chip is good. He's got many billions of dollars. So he's fine. He would have just had more billions. See what you think. Does Chip have a chip on his shoulder about listening to the advice of investment experts who told him to what? Diversify his holdings. This is cut 2A. Let's This is less than a minute. Here's Chip Wilson on selling his shares.
Over the past years, since you haven't been active in Lululemon management, what have you found to be your most interesting work, and what's been what's been the most interesting thing for you and your biggest accomplishment?
So I've come out of Lululemon because everyone told me to diversify. I'd listen to smart people, and I did that. Now, that's so what things do I want to diversify myself in? Well, as I was selling down Lululemon, I was going, this is the only thing I think about all day long, is technical athletic clothing. Mm-hmm. What a mistake I've made actually selling down and getting out of the company that I know more than anybody else in the world about.
So what you're saying then, Chip, is you listen to smart people and they screwed you. It's kind of... I find it hard to muster up, empathy, since I don't have billions of dollars. Like, did he actually just complain about that? It sounded like good, smart people, and I listened to smart people, told me to sell my Lululemon shares, and boy, that was a bad idea, because I know more about that than anyone. So, interested to hear what you all are hearing in that. Our first Chip Wilson sound of the day, because I hear two things. I hear a billionaire complaining he doesn't have more billions of dollars. I hear a billionaire blaming other people for his not having more billions of dollars. And then I hear a billionaire complaining because I'm the smartest person on the planet about this one thing and I should have more money because of it.
Ew.
I don't know about you, but ew. Not my favorite Chip Wilson moment. But it gets worse. So don't change that dial. Keep it where it is. I'm Maggie Dawn. She's Anya Esther. You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Come join us. The water is warm while the air is cold. 844-967-2789. That is Party at a Rich Dude's House by Kesha. Hey, Kesha, if you're listening, let's go hit up Chips over the weekend. Maybe we can party at a Rich Dude's House. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. 844-967-2789. Give us a call. Say hello to Anya. Wherever you may be listening from in the state of Wisconsin or well beyond, we do have on the line one of our frequent callers, friend of the network and friend of the show, Tom from LA. How are you, Tom? What say you this fine afternoon?
Hey, Maggie, I'm good. First off, go pack, go. And you know what I find is so refreshing is the fact that this really is Matt LaFleur's team now.
Yes.
And I don't feel like in the past, when some of these stars get so big, it almost becomes like their team. And he shows what it's like to actually bring people together and not divide and conquer like previous occupants of the governorship in Wisconsin said to Widow Hendricks, our strategy is to divide and conquer the people of Wisconsin. That is the complete opposite of what the Green Bay Packer organization and the sports in Wisconsin does, which is unite people together. And we just really need to think about what a great feeling that is when we are all united in one cause. And it would be nice if the people would start to realize that the billionaire class always has us fighting each other so they can steal we, the people's money out the back door. And yeah, it's just so refreshing to see exactly the team that, you know, that is the only socialistic football team in the NFL where it is owned by the people, that is a team that is potentially going to go far here in the playoffs. I think they have a real, real shot at it because they are coming together more so than any other team out there as a unit and being excited for each other. And it's not about one or two players. It is about the team, and the team is about we the people, and that is what democracy is about. It's not about authoritarianism, and it is not about dictatorships, and it is not about fascism. If you want that, you can see what's happening in the Gaza Strip. That is what you get when you don't have good government. Republicans say they hate government. Republicans say they don't like government. I say that we tell those people in power, all you Republicans out there, in fact, tell these people in power that we, the people, are the government, and these people need to go, because if you don't like your job or if you don't like the concept of your job, you don't belong in that job.
Tom, I couldn't have said it any better myself. Thank you. And in fact, you well stole my thunder a wee bit, because the place I wanted to get to was, what do these two things have in common? Which is the excitement that I think every Wisconsinite and every Packers fan feels right now, and the power of sport to unite, and how much more fun it is to get behind a team that is an underdog team that is simply coalescing together. How much more likely, in my opinion, it is that teams like that actually win, because they're not being driven exclusively by one or two massive egos. That there's a shared sense of responsibility, that those things often on the sports gridiron, pitch, field, whatever your venue of play is, that oftentimes it is those sorts of teams that succeed well beyond what anyone would have thought they were capable of. I certainly have that feeling about the Packers today. And I also have that feeling about every one of us. We shouldn't be ceding our common sense to the billionaire class or to talkers on the radio. We shouldn't be ceding our sense of community to others, because it's the billionaires and the elected officials that are the others. Us, it's just the rest of us, right? Like, let's come together. Let's coalesce the rest of us as a team of underdogs, because the system ain't built for me and you. It's built for the Chip Wilsons. It's built for the NFL owners. That's who all this is built for. It's built for the Donald Trumps and the Ron Johnsons. It's also built for the very, very rich Democrats. But that's not the way it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be a governmental system, a system of economics, of capitalism, that works for most of us, the working people, the regular folks. And we can again, in this state, become more like the Packers under Matt LaFleur. We can embrace that we don't need an Aaron Rodgers. We need a quarterback who reflects who we are as a state. A quarterback who wants to bring us together, not separate us into us and them, who wants to distort reality. You don't win games by lying about what the defense looks like when you're in the huddle with the quarterback. That's not how you win. Just ignore those guys out there. That's how a wide receiver gets his bell rung across the middle if the QB's reading the defense bad and sets him up to get hurt. That's not what we do on the field. That's not what we do as community members either. It's us, everybody. Maybe not against the billionaires, but at least us coming together to be sure the billionaires aren't robbing us blind at every chance they can get. Jim and Appleton, exactly right. Chip Wilson has sour grapes because it doesn't have more billions of dollars that belong more properly with the workers that help create the product that Lululemon sells at price points that I can't believe people are willing to pay for yoga pants that are too thin to cover up big butts, that Chip Wilson said on Good Morning America a few years ago that fat people shouldn't wear his clothes anyways. I'll be back with more Chip Wilson, more Packers reflections. It's Deep Thoughts with Jack Handy, Maggie Dawn, and Anya Esther here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Keep it locked, everybody. Wine stain on the sofa. Indeed it does, Cindy. We couldn't agree more here on the Civic Media Radio Network. That's Cindy Lauper's Money Changes Everything. Changes everything. It changes everybody. I don't know a whole lot of folk that get like mad cheddar and are all of a sudden like, I'm thinking more rationally than before. I don't know that that really happens. I think part of it, you know, with great wealth and or incredible power, political, economic, otherwise, whether you're a Harvey Weinstein, right, a Woody Allen, a Donald Trump, a Chip Wilson, it separates you from normal people. It just does. Because normal people don't have a lot of power, or at least we don't think we do. We go to work and we work every day. We're not going to see names and headlines, all that kind of stuff. So I was kind of doing a meditation on all of these things, and Chip Wilson happened to do this interview with Forbes. We're listening to some of the sound. Chip Wilson, if you don't know, if you're just tuning in, and thanks to any new listeners out there. Hoorah, you rock. We're talking about Chip Wilson, former CEO of Lululemon, who was just interviewed by Forbes. I listened to the whole thing. There were four or five things that the guy said that I thought were pretty alarming. We listened to one of them before the break. And it basically was Chip Wilson complaining that he knows more about technical athletic wear than anyone in the world. And some people told him that he needed to diversify. So he sold some of his shares, most of his shares of Lululemon. And oh, gee whiz, the shares went up 160%+ over COVID. And he's crabby because he doesn't have more billions of dollars. I mean, I bet all of us have heard this phrase, diminishing marginal returns. Not at your radio if you've heard this phrase before. You know, what the hell? Some economist just said that. I hate it when they talk to me like that because I have no idea what it means. Every time you hear that from now on, I want you to picture the 100th Rolls Royce that you buy, the 50th Lamborghini, the 8th enormous home on a lake. Probably not going to have as much value to you, generate as much enjoyment for you as the first one. That's diminishing marginal returns. Also, my first Krispy Kreme donut, delicious, amazing. I love it. Give me more. But by my sixth, that's a diminishing marginal return. In other words, the return, the value that I get from the thing lessens the more I get of them. That is true of wealth. And on top of that, I think oftentimes incredible wealth, and I'm not talking about a few million. Most of us need, if we ever want to retire, we're going to need a few million, right? That's how much it costs. You want to send a kid to college and help them pay for it, it'll be a couple million, at least a mil in a few years, given what's happening with the cost of higher education. What I mean is that wealth, where it is in the multiple billions of dollars, corrupts in some way, shape, or form nearly universally and without exception. And I do mean the Jeff Bezoses too. Of course I do. We're using Chip Wilson to explore that. So the next thing I want to listen to is cut three, Anya. This is, and this, again, we ended that first one that we listened to last segment, where he basically said, I'm the smartest person on the planet about this stuff. And if I wouldn't have listened to these so-called smart people, I'd be so much more wealthy. So now listen to this.
I know more than anybody else in the world about. Mm-hmm. And so, and because I'm an entrepreneur, I'm almost 5 years ahead, and that doesn't really work with a lot of, I'd say, accounting, corporate type of people, you know. So I went, okay, well, I need to get myself into something I can control. I have to be a believer in what I'm doing. I have to see what the future is, and I have to develop something to live into the future. Mm-hmm. So I was a kid playing Monopoly and I played for like 10 years. I know every ratio, every rent, every house, every property. I mean, it's just who I was. So it became easier for me to think about going into real estate, and it was fun, and it is fun running it. Who know way more than I do. And there's a thousand million nuances to run a great business. And I know them all about technical apparel, and I don't know them all about real estate. So I'm proud to say that I have people that are running that perfectly, and I love them for it. And I love that. I feel like I'm right in the middle of the biggest change in the way people have dressed in the history of the world. Sweden, the company is mm-hmm. probably 90% of the time.
And so when you're advising, I understand that you're, you know, advising these companies and helping push them in the right direction. Are you following the Lululemon playbook, or how are you catering to, you know, these five different outdoor brands?
The Lululemon playbook, I believe it hasn't changed at all because, I mean, we set it up, I think, perfectly from that.
Okay. I mean, Anya's listening along with me. Anything in that jump out at you? I mean, there's so much in these little snippets.
Yeah, in editing this today, I kind of would keep realizing I wasn't listening to him because it was just kind of word soup at times, but also to just hear him like, I don't know, I know more about this than anyone else. It's too bad that I'm not like that for real estate, but thankfully I have all these people who do it for me. It's like, do you mean employees? Like, yeah, they aren't. Yeah, if they're doing it for you, then shouldn't they kind of be the millionaires, and maybe not you, the guy who's openly admitted he doesn't know anything, it kind of sounds like. I don't know. I can't stand this guy.
So one thing that's really interesting here, right, and that I try to guard against all the time, and I require you all that are listening, and Anya and my other colleagues and friends from Civic Media, I try not to word salad, right? Like, I might say something complicated, or we're doing a deep dive on some technical stuff, but I try not to just word bubble blurb at you, right? I endeavor in whatever it is that I'm doing to speak clearly and directly so that everybody can understand what the heck I'm saying, to not use things like diminishing marginal returns. This guy, and I find this sometimes to be very true, you listen to really wealthy people or some politicians, and they just word salad all this stuff at you, and the individual words sound kind of reasonable, and he's not fired up, right? He's like, blah, 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 I did this thing, and then the other thing, and blah, 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 blah. Okay, Chip, nothing sounds, don't be threatened here. But when you actually think about what he has been asked and what he's saying in response and what the response comprises of, it's like, here's my id. And it's pretty scary, actually. I find so much of what his worldview is to be like, yes, this is actually the problem, sir. So just to recap, that last one we listened to started with, I know more about this than anyone else in the world, because I'm 5 years ahead of everybody. I don't like to listen to those corporate bean counter types, right? They don't jive with me because I know more. So I had to find something that I can control perfectly so I don't have to listen to the bean counter types. So, you know, because I played Monopoly for a long time when I was a kid, I figured, hey, I'll be a great real estate investor, and then I'll just hire all the people that actually know something about it, because Monopoly is not a reasonable basis to know anything about real estate investment. It's a freaking game that was invented post-depression to teach kids about the perils of capitalism. Not a good training ground, sir. But because I played Monopoly, I actually, you know, I hired some people, and they're perfect. Does that sound like anybody? I hired the perfect people who do this perfectly, and I love them. Does this sound like anyone else? But then, you know, before he lets go of this, he has to remind us, I know them all. I know all of the things about athletic wear. So if you couldn't actually tell what the heck his new businesses are, because that was a word salad, it's two things. He's doing real estate investing, and he now owns basically a venture capital firm that's in conjunction with a Chinese outfit. So yeah, he's China. And he owns 5 athletic wear brands now, or parts of them, as an investor. So that's what he's talking about. I know more than anyone else on the planet. I'm 5 years ahead of all these bean counter corporate types. They limit me. I need something where I control it all. So I figured, yeah, I played this game, so that must mean I'm an expert in it. But then I really hired the experts, and they're perfect, and they love me, and I love them for it. But don't forget, I'm the best at all this stuff, so I own these other 5 brands. Like, that's what he's saying. I'm sorry, if you showed up at work and said this, you would get your butt fired. Now, listen, I hope there are some conservatives yelling at their radio going, yeah, Maggie, the guy made billions of dollars in Lululemon, so he must know something. Grant you that. What I'm saying is, what doing well convinces people about their other abilities, right? That you extrapolate what some would argue is, yes, hard work, yes, smarts. Also, anybody that I know that's super successful also says there's a decent amount of luck. Timing. And you attribute that all to your own innate smartness and value. You presume that you're right in everything else, and you start moving through the world this way. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not denigrating Mr. Wilson's accomplishments in building Lululemon. He did do that. I still think $120 yoga pants are stupid, but maybe that's just me and I don't get it, or I'm a fat girl and I'm not paying $120 for yoga pants where my butt still shows through them. that for $120, my butt should be covered. I don't know. Just me here? But this is what it changes how he starts to think about himself in relation to everyone else in the world. You and I would never go to a job interview and be like, well, I played this game, so I figured I'm an expert in it. Give me a job. Can you imagine?
I don't know, Maggie. I played telephone as a kid, and that was kind of one of my qualifications for this job was I'd heard a lot of people talk before and I'd said things about it. So I don't know.
We engaged in gossip when we were in middle school, so we got to be good at this.
Yep.
Thank heaven I didn't get screened too hard for this gig either. But I mean, really? All right. Let's listen to a little bit more sound. I want to be sure we don't run out. How much time do we have left here before we... Oh, we're almost on it. Let's just listen to... We're just going to do cut five. This we can listen to, then we'll come back after some important messages. If you want to get in on this convo, I will be going to the phones when we come back. 844-967-2789. Take a listen to this. More Chip Wilson.
So what I'm really getting at there is that Lululemon has the opportunity to become a brand. But in order to become a brand, you've got to be clear that you don't want certain customers coming in.
Yeah. Don't want customers coming in. I don't know about you, Anya, but if I want everybody listening to our show here on the Civic Media Radio Network, give us a call. Say hi to Anya, 844-967-2789. We'll be back with more after these important messages.
I like to do a song of great social and political import. It goes like this. Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? My friends all drive Porsches. I must make amends. Worked hard all my lifetime. No help from my friends. So, oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? Oh Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes?
It goes on. Everybody hopefully singing along with Janis, one of my favorite artists of all time. Yeah. You know, here's another billionaire recently in the news, apparently has lost some perspective, Bill Ackman. Here's the perspective he lost. His wife also plagiarized. Oops. You know, when you attack the Harvard president for plagiarism, you might want to actually educate yourself about how frequent it is amongst academic experts. And those with PhDs to use common terms within a particular specialty or summarize without citation, because his wife did it a whole bunch of times. Don't you worry. We've gotten some feedback from folks about what they want to hear from me this year on the Maggie Dawn Show. I am going to be covering the plagiarism discussion this Wednesday. So do not miss that. That's going to be this Wednesday. Another huge programming note. You may have seen big, big, big news dropped, not just big for Milwaukee County, but big for the whole state because of what this might mean more broadly. Also what it might do for turnout. But Milwaukee County's District Attorney John Chisholm announced on Friday that he will not be seeking another term. He has been the elected district attorney since 2006. Combined with his predecessor, E. Michael McCann, they comprise together 69 years of only two people holding the position of the elected district attorney in Milwaukee County. Guess who's got the exclusive interview with District Attorney John Chisholm? It is I on this show. John will be on with me on Monday. That is 1 week from today, January 15th. You are not going to want to miss that. I am so excited to speak with a man that I've been privileged to work with over the last 7 years. Also, we keep talking about Chevron and SCOTUS ethics. There's been some interesting developments, has there not? And so I'm not going to treat those two things as distinct topics, friends. I'm going to tackle them both tomorrow because, like much of what I try to do on this show, with Anya's help and in partnership with all of you listening, is pull the through lines through stuff that seems not related and show us all how it is indeed connected. We're going to go to the phones. If you want in on this topic, 844-567-2789. That we shouldn't cede what we think or how we think or how our government is run or who the presidents of our universities are to the billionaire class. Because when you get that rich, I think it does kind of change your relationship with reality a little bit, and not for the good. We've been listening to statement after statement by former Lululemon founder, well, he's still the founder, former CEO, who's a billionaire many, many, many times over. So before we go to the phones, probably the most incredible exchange of the entire interview came very early on. This is going to be cut one, Anya.
It kind of made me think, like, how many diseases are there out there, rare diseases where somebody could just come in and put a bunch of cash in, on the table, like a billionaire like yourself, and the problem is solved. Has it kind of made you think about, you know, the justice of drug development and like the economics of it all in terms of like, there's a lot of solvable issues just sitting out there. We just don't have the resources.
Well, I think for the big ones, I mean, you can look at cancer or heart disease or that. I mean, I think that's where governments get involved. I mean, if you have to build a highway, the governments are going to get involved to like build a big highway, but they're not going to get involved to build a back alley in a piece of property they don't own. That's in order to have that happen, you have to have private money in. FSHD is rare, but not so rare that if a solvent, a drug can easily bring in $2 to $3 billion into a pharmaceutical end. And that, I think that's what people are seeing. Mm-hmm. And so how do we then work with the health officials in schools and the phys ed teachers to start identifying these people and start, you know, having them identified? So, because the younger you can almost get anybody in any disease, or the sooner they have it, then the easier it is to work with people around, you know, physical fitness. Diet has a lot to do with it. I think, you know, mental well-being has a lot to do with it. Mm-hmm. So that's in part of the aura of saying, okay, there's a lot more people than we know of, and that gives a lot of incentive to the pharmaceutical companies in order to have something occur.
Okay, so I will unword cloud this for you. She asks him, what is the responsibility of billionaires like yourselves to help fund cures to the diseases and medical things that plague millions and millions of people? She's asking a version of the insulin question, which is, if you, because you're super rich, can control insulin manufacturing, is it okay for you to charge a ton of money? I don't know what he's talking about with government and like heart disease and then alleys. And I don't really want to know because it scares me a little bit. But I think what he was saying was, well, government will just go take care of the big stuff. But heart disease isn't solved with a pill. And by the way, he references a very rare form of muscular dystrophy, which he has, and he is personally funding research. But he tells you why he's doing that. He says, because with this, there's enough people that a certain pharmaceutical company might make $2 to $3 billion, so it'll be worthwhile. And boy, we really need to work with the schools so we can actually identify kids younger and younger to create customers for this drug that I think should get invented by a pharmaceutical company and the research that I might be funding, so that we can do what? Make more billions of dollars. Jack from Merrimack, you got about 30 seconds, my friend. We're running out of time, my friend.
Oh, boy. Okay. First thing I want to say is this is one of the job creators, the guys that got trillions in tax welfare a couple of years. Well, now it's about 7 years ago. And what's his main concern? Making more money. I often ask this question of my conservative friends, and I've never received a good answer. How much is enough? Since I'm out of time, that's about it.
Well, Jack, you said it well. You said it fast. I think that is the question. Is our tax system fair? Do we have an actual minimum wage? I say we sure don't. And we shouldn't be listening to billionaires to set our public policy. I'm Maggie Dawn. She's on you, Esther. We'll be back tomorrow with another edition of The Maggie Dawn Show.